senators asked me to say a few words about who I am and about my passion, which is integrating the best of ancient knowledge, holistic focus on wellness and health with modern technology. My name is Michael H. Cohen, and I practice healthcare and business law based in Beverly Hills, California. I've written 6 books on healthcare law and policy, focusing on integrative medicine, telemedicine, emerging technologies, and how the law can support the emergence of health and wellness in a new way. When I travel around the world and I'm asked, from your perspective, what is America's position on how we integrate holistic knowledge with modern technology? I talk about how maybe what we think is the pattern isn't really what we want to build. Maybe that whole edifice has to crumble. Maybe the past has to be smashed and broken away so we can build something from the molecular level up. When I travel to Dubai to advise on the creation of Dubai Healthcare City for Harvard Medical International, we didn't really have a plan. We had to create it. We had to create something that was going to work in a fresh culture, in a new context. So we borrowed what we could, but then we discarded a lot. And we had to be very creative about how to put together something that would create standards of practice that would work in the region, that would operate locally with the wisdom infused from a global awareness and knowledge base of what it takes to create an integrated system of health and healing that's going to be effective. Let's talk a little bit more about innovation. You know, innovation doesn't just happen in America. It could happen in a garage in Switzerland, in a tent in India, in somebody's back of somebody's dining room somewhere in China, or in a science lab over in Australia. Innovation can happen anywhere in the world, but the question is, how do these really passionate, creative people get their product to market in the U.S. when we have a regulatory system that really narrows the funnel of what's acceptable? We have standards that are more stringent than what happens in Europe or Asia or in other continents. I have a client who designed a mobile app that's going to connect doctors and patients. Basically, people are going to be uploading photos of their skin through their phone, and a bunch of dermatologists way on the other side of the world are going to be diagnosing and making prescriptions. The FDA considers that a mobile medical app, and how do you get that through the FDA? I researched the mobile medical app guidance, and I advised my client that what we need to do is to find the least restrictive, least burdensome regulatory path. And what we found is an exemption where she does not need a burdensome application and submission known as a 510K. This is what I do. I walk hand in hand with the client through the regulatory puzzle, and we find a solution that's going to help them bring their product to market. Because innovation shouldn't depend on a regulatory system that's anachronistic and old. I'm all for ancient knowledge, but I'm not for an ancient regulatory system. Some of these rules go back to the late 19th century. Some are based on disasters that happened in the 1930s. We really need to move forward so we can stay competitive with the rest of the world. Not only that, but it's important to provide opportunities for those entrepreneurs that are coming up with their dreams and visions in the backs of their garages, restaurants, dining halls, tents, whatever it may be, out in the desert in another country, so that they can bring their passion not only to their own local markets, but also globally, including America. That's why the regulatory system and the legal judgment needs to hold the balance so the standards of practice are there, but also people are free to be creative, to innovate, to dream, to boldly go where no one has gone before. That's what this work is about. And so I decided that I was going to write my third book. My first two were very successful. They've been used in hospitals, medical centers, medical schools, acupuncture, chiropractic schools, all over the world. But I decided that I really needed to break out and write another book. And this book was going to be about my experience with energy medicine. Because I had gone when I was a Wall Street lawyer and I'd studied hypnotherapy, energy healing, the mind, the subconscious, neuro-linguistic programming, all these different techniques. I was fascinated. And I thought, how am I going to write this book? I'm a Harvard Medical School professor. This is the bastion of conservative medical knowledge. Where's this going to come from? Well, I just sat down on my computer and I was pleasantly surprised. I mean, this thing just flowed out of me. Because really, it was about my deep desire to connect with the truth that was coming within me. That there are no more taboos. that we should write what we feel and what we experience, that we can be solid, grounded citizens of the world. We can be priests of technology, we can be law school professors, we can be medical school professors, we can be government regulators, we can be entrepreneurs or techies or geeks or ordinary citizens or patients who have specific needs or family members of loved ones who are in hospitals. And we can be very grounded, concerned citizens of the world. And we can also pay attention to what's coming up from deep within. And so I wrote this book, Future Medicine, to describe that experience for me, that explosion of awakening, that I could be a Harvard Medical School professor, a Wall Street law firm, blue chip law firm graduate, a former law clerk, and just a regular person. And I could also be deeply mystical and deeply trusting in my path. And I could bridge different forms of knowledge and put them together from my perspective as a lawyer to support health and human healing. It's great that people have come here today from all over the planet to share their own stories about health and healing. And I'd like to talk to you a little bit about my childhood growing up in Michigan. My mom was a doctor, and when I went on rounds with her at the hospital in Detroit, I fainted. And it was a big deal that they had to bring orange juice to revive me to get my blood sugar back up. So I knew the medicine wouldn't be my path. Of course, I ended up teaching in a medical school, go figure. But then, I also have two brothers, and my brothers and I got into a lot of snowball fights because it was very cold in Michigan. And usually my brothers would instigate, but I was the oldest, and so my dad always told me, you have to make peace. Don't fight with your brothers, that's how wars get started. And I was profoundly impressed with that. And I committed myself over my life toward a path of peace. To me, holistic healthcare and medicine are all about building peace. Healing and health are really the prerequisite to wholeness, to creating a more peaceful world. It's a pathway where we can share knowledge about what makes us feel better. Because when we're healthy, happy, and productive, that's when we have a lot to contribute to one another as brothers and sisters in this family upon the planet. And that's why in my scholarly work, I've emphasized medical pluralism. Pluralism is a word, but it's really about the union of all of our shared knowledge from around the world so that together we can create a better platform for health for everyone. Let's sum this all up. What are we talking about today? We're talking about three things: innovation, passion, and regulation, and how we bring all three together to create the best system of personalized healthcare for everyone. I so much appreciate your invitation to speak at this conference and everyone sharing their different ideas from all over the world, from different cultures and traditions. Thank you for inviting me. I look forward to the rest of the conference. Thank you very much.